down the Via Dolorosa in Jerusalem that day. The soldiers tried to clear the narrow street, but the crowd pressed in to see the man condemned to die on Calvary. He was bleeding from a beating. There were stripes on his back, and he wore a crown of thorns upon his head, and he bore with every step the scorn of those who cried out for his death. Down the Via Dolorosa, called the way of suffering, but he chose to walk that road out of his love for you and me. Down the Via Dolorosa, all the way to Calvary. And his body will be nailed upon the cross. Jesus died to take our place so that our sins would be erased. Down the Via Dolorosa, call the way of suffering. Like a lamb came the Messiah, Christ the King. But he chose to walk that road out of his love for you and me. Down the Via Dolorosa, all the that would cleanse the souls of all men, made its way to the heart of Jerusalem. Down the Via Dolorosa, called the way of suffering, like a lamb
evening. I think that perhaps one of the most natural questions we could find ourselves asking at a time like this is just simply the question, why the cross? Why did Jesus go to the cross? Why is the cross so important? Why is the cross so celebrated? Why the cross? And so we're going to start with that question this evening and really allow it to be the driving theme through each and every portion of our time together. And with that, we're going to take a look at a passage of scripture found in Isaiah chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. And as I approach this question, along with Tyler here in just a moment, and then a little later on, Pastor Ron coming up to close it, we're all going to come around it from this passage, and we're going to be using this verse as kind of a starting point. And so to get started, what I would love to do is just really zero in and focus on the first part of verse 5 here in Isaiah chapter 53. You can follow along as I read it for you. It says, "But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him." And so as I look at this passage right away, there's a few phrases that just kind of jump off the page at us. And Isaiah is prophesying. He's talking about Jesus some 700 years before Jesus is even born. And he's describing him as this suffering servant who was pierced for our transgressions and crushed for our iniquities. And he uses these two words, pierced and crushed. And of course, these are references to the crucifixion. And we know, as we're familiar with this story, that as Jesus was nailed to the cross, he was pierced in his hands and his feet. We also know that he was pierced as the crown of thorns was placed on his head. And John's gospel even tells us that after Jesus has died, the guard, the soldier, had pierced Jesus in his side with his spear. So Jesus was pierced, but he was crushed. And this is a more figurative reference to the crucifixion. It speaks more to the emotional and the spiritual weight of the burden that Jesus carried with him, and that he carried on as he hung on the cross and as he suffered and as he died there. But the phrases that Isaiah uses here actually give us some direct insight into why Jesus suffered in this way. It says that he was pierced for our transgressions. And this word here is really just a general reference to our sin, but it speaks more directly to our rebellion. It's those moments when we decide to disobey God. That's our transgression. It says he was crushed for our iniquities. And again, we will often hear this as just a general reference to our sinfulness, and yet it can speak more directly, more specifically, to the crookedness of our fallen sin nature that each of us are born into. And this really refers to what theologians call the doctrine of depravity, which basically just means that because of Adam and Eve's decision to disobey God in the garden, their very nature was corrupted by sin at that very moment. And that sin nature has been passed down to every human being in every generation since, including you and I. And it has polluted every aspect of our human experience, including our mind and our heart and our will. And so when we see this word iniquity, we are reminded that you and I are born into this fallen condition with a natural inclination towards sin. And so when we look at these statements here in Isaiah chapter 53, verse 5, it's pretty clear that the reason Jesus went to the cross was simply for our sin. He went to the cross for our sin, but I think it goes beyond that, because we look more closely at the statement that follows this, and the prophet here, Isaiah, he says, "The punishment that brought us peace was on him." And so now we begin to see that Jesus didn't just go to the cross for something. He went to the cross for someone. And of course, that means you and me. He didn't just go to the cross for our sin. He went to the cross for the sinner. And here's why this is such good news, just in case we've forgotten it tonight. But the Apostle Paul tells us in Romans chapter 6, 23, that the wages of sin is death. And he actually takes this a little farther in his letter to the church in Ephesus, Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 3. Listen, as I read this for you, it says, "As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live, when you follow the ways of this world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath." Paul reminds us in these three verses, in no uncertain terms, that each and every one of us, all of us, at one time were spiritually dead because of our sins. We were lost, separated from Christ, separated from God because of our sins. And he says this because, and he points out really three reasons for this. He says at some point, all of us have followed the cultural influences of this world. He says that all of us at one point have taken the bait and listened to the lies of our enemy, who we know, of course, is the devil. And he says that at some time, all of us, every single one of us, we've gratified the cravings of our flesh. And it's all of these things, all three of them, the world, the devil, our flesh, all of them have conspired against us to ensure that our lives are inevitably and absolutely corrupted by sin. And no matter how hard we try to change this, we're simply incapable of doing anything to clean ourselves up or to ever meet that high standard of God's holiness on our own. In Paul's words, we were by our very nature deserving of wrath. Our sin had made us justly deserving of God's judgment and earned for us a penalty that had to be paid. And that's why Jesus went to the cross. The prophet Isaiah actually introduces this doctrinal belief of substitutionary atonement, that when Jesus went to the cross, this innocent, sinless man died in the place as a substitute for guilty sinners. And all of our transgressions and iniquities were transferred to him at the cross, so that through our faith and trust in him, his righteousness has now been credited to us. And so by some miracle of grace, when God looks at you and I, those of us who once were lost and dead in our sins, he sees the righteousness of Christ on us. And so when we ask, why the cross? I want us to remember that it was for our sin. But even more, it was for the sinner. And it's by his wounds, as Tyler will share with us in just a moment, that we are healed. In a podcast interview I listened to sometime last year, a pastor was being interviewed and he was asked just where he had found this passion for reaching lost people in his city. And, you know, where did you get this passion? Where did that come from? And he just responded, he said, you know, I've never gotten over being saved. I've never gotten over being saved. And that statement has stayed with me ever since. And I found myself reflecting on my own heart, my own attitude toward my salvation in Christ. And I asked myself, have I ever gotten over this? And I would put that to you as well. Have you ever gotten over the miracle of your salvation? You see, my concern is that if we somehow hold a casual view of our sin, or we take too lightly the ramifications of our sinful choices, or we fail to remember the price that was paid for our salvation, that we could begin to take for granted this incredible injustice, this injustice that a sinless man would go to the cross and bear the punishment for my sins. And in failing to remember our sin and the punishment that brings us peace, my concern is that in some way we will have just gotten over the miracle of our salvation. It was our sin that sent Jesus to the cross, and it was on the cross that the punishment of our transgressions and iniquity was paid in full. As my time winds down, I just want to take a look at one more passage of scripture with you. So I want to look very quickly at Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. And here in one of my favorite verses, the writer challenges us to throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And up to this point, you know, we've talked a lot about sin in these few short minutes together already. But mostly we've talked about it in a very broad and general sense, you know, our sin nature and the sins of our past. But here the writer of Hebrews wants to speak directly to the sin. It's that very specific to you thing that you struggle with. In some translations, it's even rendered the besetting sin. It's that thing that just keeps coming up again and again. It's that habit or the weakness or that flaw that just continues to rear its ugly head. What is that for you? As we've been talking about this, maybe that's come to mind for you. I know it has for me. I've spent all week meditating on this, and I can tell you with absolute certainty it's right there at the forefront of my mind. And maybe it's come to your mind as well. And I want us to hold that thought, because that sinful habit, that lifestyle that is outside of God's boundaries, that tendency toward pride or greed or selfishness or anger, that impulsive behavior, that fill in the blank, whatever it is for you, that's why Jesus went to the cross. He went to the cross for that thing. And so I want us to remember that and to bring that sin before the Lord in a posture of confession this morning. Before we do that, though, the writer of Hebrews, he finishes verse 2 with one of my favorite lines in all of scripture. He says that for the joy set before him, Jesus endured the cross. For the joy set before him. I mean, Jesus looked at the cross and he saw the agony. He saw the piercing and the crushing. But he looked beyond that. And beyond the cross, he saw the joy of completing the Father's will, the joy of his resurrection and exaltation, the joy of bringing you, along with many other believers, to the Father in glory. And for that joy, he willingly went to the cross. And on the cross, when he said the words, "It is finished," that meant that his work of dying for your sins in your place was perfect and complete. And so in your seats, as we sing these songs together, I just want to encourage you to enter into just a private time of confession between you and God. I'm not going to ask you to say anything out loud. I'm not going to ask you to write anything down. We're not going to invite you to come forward. Just in your seats, privately between you and the Lord. And I just invite you to confess that besetting sin as we discussed a minute ago. Without fear or reservation, just lay it at the foot of the cross in full disclosure before the Father. And as you do, thank him for the forgiveness and the healing that is ours through the blood of Jesus poured out for you on the cross. Would you stand with me as we worship together?
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turned His face away as wounded mother chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon the cross, my sin upon His shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held Him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. It is finished. I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my ransom. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my ransom. Yes, this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my ransom.
You can go ahead and be seated. Well, just as Eric said, it's an honor for us to be able to share and just to be with all of you tonight on Good Friday, to be able to reflect together, to share some thoughts with you about Jesus and the cross and what it meant for Him and His followers back then, what it means for all of us 2,000 years later here today as well. And as He introduced to us, I think that passage in Isaiah 53 is such a great passage for us to reflect on together, because when we think about the question, why the cross, I think it's the essence, what we read about in that passage, just the essence of what the cross was all about. And as Eric pointed out for us, one of the things that Isaiah 53 reveals to us is that when it comes to why the cross, why did Jesus do what He did in what we're reflecting on tonight? It was for our sin, but we also, as we read on there, we see that it was also for something else that I want to point out for you and spend a few minutes reflecting on with you tonight, which is this. As we read on in Isaiah 53, verse 5, we see that it was not just for our sin, but it was also for our healing. I'm going to pull that scripture back up there and just read this for you again. Isaiah 53, verse 5, as Eric just talked about, he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities, and the punishment that brought us peace was on him. But then we have this line, and there's just a few words there, but they're powerful words, they're profound words, and I want to just think about them as I read them for you here in this moment where it says this, and by his wounds, we are what? We're healed. I don't know about you, but I love those words. I love that line. Again, they're simple words, but loaded with such promise and inspiring such hope for us, such powerful meaning for our lives. When we think about what Jesus did for us on the cross, but not only do they inspire hope and instill such a sense of promise for us, as I reflect on those words, they also raise a question for me that I want to kind of reflect on with you for a moment tonight, which is this. When we think about this idea that by his wounds we're healed, one of the questions that comes to mind is just this: well, healed of what? And healed in what ways? And I think there's several of them that I want to point out for you again as we just spend some time reflecting on the cross tonight and the fact that by his wounds we are healed. I want to just talk to you briefly about a few ways that I think we experience healing through the cross. The first one is kind of the most obvious one, one that Eric was alluding to as well, and just this idea that by Jesus' wounds we experience healing in terms of his kind of reconciling work in our lives and healing a broken relationship with God. As he pointed out, all of us, he came for our sin, which is good because all of us have sin, as he said, and our sin separates us from God. Our rebellion against God, our rejection of God kind of removed ourselves from him. And as Eric pointed out, there's nothing we could do to fix that for ourselves. And so Jesus came to stand in our place, to be our substitute, to endure our separation that we chose for ourselves so that we could be reconciled again. We read about this in one of my favorite passages in all of the Bible, the book of Colossians chapter 1. We have the verses up here on the screen. Let me read these for you and just encourage you to reflect on these and the power of these words and what they mean for us. Starting in verse 19, it says this, "For God was pleased to have all of his fullness dwell in Jesus." The hymn there is talking about Jesus. He was pleased to have all of his fullness dwell in him. And then through him, through Jesus, to reconcile to himself. God the Father was pleased to reconcile all things back to himself through Jesus, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood, Jesus' blood shed on the cross. And then it says this, once all of us in the room, the people that he was writing to, all of us here tonight, once you were alienated, you were separated from God, you were enemies toward God in your minds because of your evil behavior. But it says, but now he has reconciled you back to him by Christ's physical body through death, through what he did on the cross to present you holy in his sight. It's one of the ways that by his wounds we're healed of a broken relationship with God through the reconciling work of Jesus. The second way I want to point out for you tonight as we reflect on this together is not only the reconciling work that we see Jesus doing on the cross, but also what we might call the releasing work of Jesus in what he accomplished for us on the cross. Here's what I mean by that. I think sometimes, and I appreciate so much of what Eric shared with us tonight, because I think sometimes we can underestimate sin and what it is and what it does to us. And many times we can kind of treat it as this kind of side nuisance that every once in a while it pops up and we got to deal with it or do something about it. But for the most part, we can kind of live our lives and pretend it doesn't exist. And yet one of the prevailing themes that we find in the Bible is this, that left to ourselves, apart from Jesus, this sin that we inherited, this sin that we've all contributed to in our own ways in our lives is actually our master. It's not just some side thing. It's like the thing for us apart from Jesus. We're actually, the Bible describes it this way, we're actually slaves to it. We're slaves to sin and darkness and evil and the ruler of this world, the devil, who is doing all sorts of dark and evil work in it. We're actually bound to that with no hope of releasing or rescuing or setting free ourselves. And this is what's so profound in what Jesus did on the cross, because when he died for us there, Jesus demonstrated victory over all of that, over the sin and evil and darkness and death and even the devil himself. who's held us and our entire world in bondage. To use Jesus' metaphor that he used in Mark chapter 3, he described it this way. He talked about going into Satan's house, so to speak, and because Jesus is stronger than him, being able to tie him up so that he could let loose those that Satan had tied up and bound up. He could set the hostages free. Sometimes when we think about the cross, it almost looks like on the cross on Good Friday that Satan was winning, that darkness was overcoming the light, that evil was on the march and nobody and nothing could stop it. And yet actually what we see happening there is that is Jesus setting the stage for us and for all of history to see that even when it looked like all hope was lost, even when he gave sin and Satan and darkness and death an opportunity to give him their best shot, even when he went into their territory and he gave them home field advantage, because of what we'll celebrate in a couple days, his resurrection from the dead, we see that even when it seemed that all authority and power belonged to that, in fact, it still and always only belonged to Jesus. And the hope and promise for us is that when we belong to him then, that the authority and power over sin and death and darkness and even the devil himself in our world, that we get to experience his power and authority over that as well, his releasing work for us and setting us free. We read about this in a couple of passages as well in Hebrews 2:14. It says this, because God's children are human beings, all of us made of flesh and blood, it says the Son, Jesus, also became flesh and blood, for only as a human being could he come and die, and only by dying could he break the power of the devil who had the power of death over us and this world. In Colossians 2:15, it says, Jesus, having disarmed the powers and authorities, the spiritual forces of evil at work in our world, he made on the cross a public spectacle of them. I love that description. Triumphing over them by the cross. We choose to belong to Jesus and receive not only his reconciling work, but his releasing work as well. In that way, by his wounds, we can be healed. I think some of you are here tonight and just need to be reminded of that, that just like we see on the cross in your life, in your home, in your marriage, in your relationships, in your own heart, in the places and spaces and challenges that you find yourself in, when it seems like darkness is overtaking you, when it seems like all of the worst that sin and death and the devil himself can stack up against you, and that you have no hope of rescue or freedom from that, when we look to the cross and receive what he did for us there, we experience healing by his wounds. We can be healed. Third and last way I want to just share with you tonight is not only through his reconciling work and his releasing work, but also what we might call Jesus' revealing work on the cross. You see, there wasn't just healing found in the accomplishments of the cross, but also the example of the cross, what we see actually happening there. And there are a couple things that I think Jesus reveals to us there about ourselves and about him. I think in the cross and in that scene and in that story, we're reminded of just how lost we are, and also reminded of just how loving God is. And we think about how lost we are. I think we see it in the people around the cross and the violence and the brutality of the cross. One of the questions I've wrestled with for years is, I understand Jesus came to die for us, but why did he have to die like that? I mean, of all the ways that he could have laid down his life, why in such a violent and brutal and torturous way as a cross? As I've thought about that, one of the reasons that I think that that Jesus chose to do that in that way is because it was the perfect way to let us see in an unmistakable way just how lost, just how evil and depraved our sin can cause us to become. That not only we could come up with something as vile and torturous as crucifying somebody, but actually to the point of crucifying, seeking to put to death the very God who created us. And I think Jesus gave us that kind of death in our place so that through the example of the cross, we could get a glimpse into just how evil and depraved our sin can cause us to become, that it would stop us in our tracks lest we ever forget or we ever begin to think that our sin isn't that bad. I think it's a great reminder for us that sin will always take us farther than we thought we could go. And it will always cost us more than we would want to give, and it will always keep us there longer than we would want to stay. And he puts it on display for all to see in order to invite us to a better way with him, the way that he demonstrated for us on the cross of selfless, sacrificial love, of dying for our enemies rather than destroying them, of being humble and honoring others rather than being full of pride and powering ourselves over others. Jesus shows us how lost we were to invite us into a better way with him, but he also shows us in the cross how loving he is. I think many of us can wrestle with so many misunderstandings and misconceptions of who God is and how he is and what he's like and what he's up to in the world. But the cross reminds us that rather than a God who's angry and vengeful with his arms crossed out to get us, we see a God who's loving and compassionate with his arms open wide out to get us back to him. And in this way, when we look to the cross, not only the things that were accomplished there, but the examples of who we can be apart from Jesus and who Jesus is, despite how we've misunderstood him, when we look to that and recognize that for who he is and who we are and who he wants us to be, I think it's another way that by his wounds, we can be healed. There's so much in the cross, so much to reflect on, so much to remember. And just as Eric a few minutes ago, when he reminded us that it was for our sin, we had an opportunity just to enter into a moment of confession as we're reminded now that it was also for our healing. We want to take the next few minutes to do something together that we call communion. And it's something Jesus did with his first followers 2,000 years ago. They gathered the night that Jesus was ultimately arrested and betrayed on his way to the cross for us and for the world. And as he gathered there, he shared with them a meal, as we talked about this past weekend here at Pathway. And he took bread and he gave it to them. He said, "This bread is my body that's given for you. I want you to eat it in remembrance of me." And then he took a cup and he passed it around and he said, "This cup is the new covenant that I'm making, not only with the Jewish people, but with the whole world. And it's a reflection of my blood that's going to be shed and poured out for the forgiveness of sins. I want you to drink it in remembrance of me." And just as they did thousands of years ago, as his church has been doing ever since, we're going to take a moment to do that together tonight. And as we do that, I want to challenge you, in light of what we reflected on in Isaiah 53, I want you to take a moment just to reflect and to remember that it was for our sin, all of us, but also for our healing. And as we eat and drink, may we be reminded of what Jesus did for us, the reconciling work of standing in our place so that we can be reconciled with the God who loves us and created us, who we can't experience life apart from. As we eat and drink, may we be reminded of the releasing work of Jesus, that he has power and authority over the powers of darkness at work in our world and in our hearts. And we don't have to be slaves anymore. We don't have to be afraid anymore. We can be set free from all of that when we belong to him. And may it remind you of the revealing work of Jesus, what we see about ourselves and what we see about him as we eat and we drink in remembrance of what he did for us on the cross. Over these next few minutes, our team's just gonna lead us in a song. And as they do, we wanna create some space for you on this Good Friday to simply make your way around the room. There's some stations up front here, I think on both sides and in the back as well. And we're just gonna spend a few minutes together. If you're a Christ follower here tonight, we wanna invite you to the table to come to grab a piece of the bread that is his body that's been given for you, and to take one of the cups as well, which is his blood that's been poured out for us for the forgiveness of our sins. And you can take that back to your seat. And as they play, we just encourage you to reflect and to remember. And then whenever you're ready, you can go ahead and eat and drink on your own again, whenever you feel like your heart is ready to do that. So I want to give you some space to do that. Let's do that together now in remembrance of him.
So we've taken the time tonight to reflect a lot on Isaiah 53:5, and I want to read the next verse to you. We all like sheep have gone astray, and each of us has turned his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. That we all like sheep have gone astray, each of us has turned to his own way. When we go on road trips, which sometimes we do, which we did a few weeks ago down to Florida, it's not uncommon for one of my kids to ask the question, "Dad, do you know where you're going?" To which most times I respond, "Absolutely," when I really don't. And I'm hoping that I end up to where I think I'm going, but the truth is that what that text tells us is that many times we think we know where we're going, but we end up at a place that leaves us dealing with a lot of regret, leaves us facing a dead end in our life, and it's all because of the reason why Christ died on that cross for each and every one of us, and that is because of our sin. That Jesus died for your sin, as Eric told us. Not just for your sin, but he died for the sinner to which we are all in the same club. That Jesus died for your healing, as Tyler told us so well. And the healing that we all desperately need, that only Christ can provide to each and every one of us. And that Jesus died for your restoration, and that he died for your redemption, and that the Lord laid on him the iniquity of not just Ron, but of Troy, and of Bill, and of Sue, and of Mark, of Tracy. The iniquity of us all. Matter of fact, Peter reminds us of that. He said, "He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds, we have been healed." And so as Jesus hung on the cross, God put upon him his own son, the punishment for our sins. And that is what was happening in that final moment when Jesus gave those final words upon the cross, where he just simply looked up to heaven and he said, my God, why have you forsaken me?" That in that moment, in that very moment, sin was laid upon Jesus. My sin and your sin. And as Paul reminds us in Corinthians, "For he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we may be made the righteousness of God in him." The innocent was punished as if guilty, that the guilty might be rewarded as if innocent. And my prayer for all of us this evening is that we would never, ever get over that truth. Is that we would never, ever get over the work that Christ did for us upon the cross. That we would never, ever get over the reality of being saved. Will you pray with me? Lord Jesus, as we have had time this evening to just sit quietly, as we've had time this evening to think about the cross, and the work that you did for us upon that cross, knowing that we are like sheep who go astray and we tend to wander our own way and we end up finding ourselves in places that lead down to a road of regret, all because of our sin. And that, Lord, you went to that cross for every name in this room, for every person in this room. That you were willing to take on the cross for the joy that was set before you. And for that, we're so very thankful. And so, Lord, I pray that as we think this evening on this Good Friday about all the good work that was done for us some 2,000 years ago in a very awful, horrible way, that would cause us to always stand in awe of the work that you did for us. We love you. It's in the name of Jesus that I pray. Amen.
When I consider what you have made, the mighty oceans, the fiery stars, the fields and forests give you praise, my Lord, my God. All glory, all